Yeah, now it's going off. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I would like to thank Fine Forum, which I am associated since very long. Dr. Sudhir Kothari, Dr. Roop sir, and everyone. And now I'm back to this session, that is Neurophilia series. That's great that Dr. Subir has started this session to incite interest in MD students and aspiring physicians. So for the want of time, I will just begin my session. It's regarding hyperkinetic movement disorders. I think hypokinetic Parkinsonism already covered by Dr. Subir in last two sessions. So it will be in a quiz format. The quiz will be conducted in a Slido app or the Slido link that can be accessed in Google Chrome. So you have to put the code, that is N2402, go to the polls option. You may enter your details here. And then as soon as the quiz is ready, the question will pop up on your screen. So let's begin. Question one, when a person gets an itch and he scratches that part, what is the type of a movement or a class of a movement? Option A, automatic. Option B, voluntary. Option C, semi-voluntary. And option D, involuntary. Okay, the timer has started. Please choose single best option. Okay, so most of you have marked voluntary, that is 50%, but please note, this is called as semi-voluntary movement. So I'll come to that. So first, I would like to tell you what is the definition of movement disorders. So movement disorders are neurological syndromes with which there is either excess of movement, which is called as hyperkinesia, or there is a paucity, a reduction of voluntary and automatic movements. And please note, it is not related to weakness or spasticity. Very previously, movement disorders were called as extrapyramidal disorders, but Dr. Stan Fan and the colleagues decided to call it as movement disorders because it is not just the extrapyramidal group of neurons, but other structures are also involved for the causation of these disorders. And coming to the type of movements, there are four classes. One is automatic, like there is no conscious effort. Imagine you're walking on your routine route or the path, or you are just thinking something and tapping on the table, that is automatic movement. Voluntary is something like I am tapping on my mouse or tapping on my keyboard, that is intentional or externally triggered when someone calls you and you turn your head. So head turning is a voluntary movement. Semi-voluntary, please remember S for S. Semi-voluntary or involuntary movement is when you have inner sensory stimulus, like some scratch, itch. When you have an inner sensory stimulus and to relieve it, you do some movement, that is called a semi-voluntary movement. So it is S for S, that is inner sensory stimulus giving an urge to move, that is semi-voluntary. And involuntary, as we all know, the myoclonus, tremor, chorea, dystonia, which are usually non-suppressible. Typical non-suppressible is myoclonus. Now the next question, which of these mentioned disorders are considered as hyperkinetic disorders? Here you can mark multiple options. So the timer has started. Chorea, myoclonus, jumpy stump, REM sleep behavior disorder. You can mark multiple options also. Okay. So many of you have marked chorea, myoclonus, but there was some confusion maybe regarding jumpy stumps and RBD. So I'll come to this. All these options are correct. These all types are considered as hyperkinesias or hyperkinetic movement disorders. So what are the types of movement disorder? What Dr. Subir discussed, hypokinesias like Parkinsonism, apraxia, blocking tics, cataplexy. Cataplexy is when at the height of emotion, there is a sudden drop. Imagine the patient is laughing and suddenly there is a jaw drop or a head drop. Drop attacks, catatonia like in schizophrenia patients, psychomotor depression, obsessional slowness, freezing phenomenon, like freezing of gait or motor arrest when the person is doing motor movement, hypothyroid slowness, hesitant gaits, rigidity, stiff muscles. These are all types of hypokinesias. And coming to hyperkinesias, abdominal dyskinesia like belly dancer dyskinesia, akathisia, ataxia, dyssynergia, athetosis balism chorea, which is a spectrum of the same disorder, dystonia, hemifacial spasm, hyperplexia, which is actually excessive startle reaction or pathologic startle reaction. Then hypnogenic dyskinesias like periodic myoclonus in sleep, jumping disorders, jumpy stumps, moving toes and fingers, myoclonus, myokemia, myorrhythmia. There are some disorders which are coming in episodic nature, like paroxysmal dyskinesias, periodic movements in sleep, REM sleep behavior disorder, restless leg syndrome, stereotypic tremor. So this list is available. You can watch it again. Now, just I want to tell you what is REM sleep behavior disorder. Please note REM and non-REM. REM sleep is associated with dreaming, and REM sleep, our somatic muscles are hypotonic or atonic. But in this disorder, this atonia is gone. So patients who are dreaming, they kind of act out during their dreams. So if they are seeing someone is stealing their purse or a thief trying to kick them, push them, and they are doing counter movements. So those shouting, screaming, or trying to catch, or trying to punch, or kicking movements are REM sleep behavior disorders. And this is usually a patient's partner or the spouse. That person notes it, and that person gets affected, because that is the one getting struck or the hurt. And even the affected individual can fall out of the bed. Just a small video. Here sound is not there, but you can make out. During sleep, the patient is having some shouting. The sound is missing, I'm sorry for that. And he's trying to kick someone. See, the left limb. So in during dream, there is some kicking movement, and there is a manifestation of that. So it is called as REM behavior disorder. Next, jumpy stumps. Whenever there is an amputation, the stump of that amputated limb can have some abnormal movements, which could be a part of spinal reflex myoclonus. So I will just show you the video. This patient is a 68-year-old male who underwent this above knee amputation for peripheral arterial occlusive disease. So here he is getting pain in the stump and involuntary twitching of the stump. Just observe this movement. Continuous raising of the movement. Sudden jerky kind of a myoclonic appearance. So this is called as jumpy stump. Now, next question. Which of the following statement or statements are true? A, normal individuals can have physiologic tremor of the frequency 10 to 12 hertz. Normal physiologic tremor is a resting tremor. An enhanced physiological tremor, that is EPT, can be seen in up to 10% population. And EPT can occur with anxiety, fatigue, metabolic disturbance associated with drugs and toxins. So get ready. The timer has started. You can mark multiple options. Okay, so 32% have marked normal physiological tremor as a resting tremor. No, physiological tremor is not resting tremor. So I'll come to that. Option first, third, and fourth are correct. So normal individuals will have physiological tremor, which is 10 to 12 hertz. It is mild and high frequency. It is usually not visible unless person is really under stress. Imagine you are undergoing your final exam with four examiners sitting in front of you. You may get these tremors. These are not resting tremor, but postural or action tremor. They are typically affecting upper extremities and usually of no clinical consequence. If you want to measure them with accelerometer, with electrophysiological testing, it can be measured. Now, coming to enhanced physiological tremor, this can be seen in 10% of the population. This is associated with anxiety. Please remember, anxiety and stress will aggravate many types of movement disorders, especially tremors. So anxiety, fatigue, metabolic like hyperthyroidism, dyselectrolytemia, drugs like valproate, lithium will cause enhanced physiological tremor. Valproate is known to cause tremor as well as some Parkinsonian features along with hair loss, as you know, and weight gain. Toxins like caffeine, smoking, and alcohol can also lead to enhanced physiological change. Now, next question. Which is the most common movement disorder? Option A, essential tremor. Option B, alcohol withdrawal tremor. Option C, cervical dystonia. Option D, myoclonus. Option E, chorea. So the timer has started. Please choose the best single correct option. I hope this Slido is working well. Dr. Subir?
Yes, sir. It's actually working well.
Okay, great. So absolutely correct. Many of you have marked the correct option. Essential tremor is the most common movement disorder. So you know that is the correct answer. These are all factual data. So I'll just come to what are the types of tremors and how they are classified. Please note there are two types. One is rest tremor and second is action tremor. Rest, when the part is fully supported and relaxed. Second is action tremor. In action tremor, there are three types. One is kinetic, when you are doing movements. Second is postural, when you outstretch the arms and keep it in front of you. And third is isometric. So imagine you are holding, squeezing your handkerchief or just making a fist very tight for longer duration, you will get isometric tremor. Coming to postural tremor, I told you, on outstretched arms, if you see tremors, that is postural. In kinetic, there are three types. So I'll come to first one, that is simple kinetic. If you just imagine finger-nose-finger test, and if the tremors are more or less similar or same from the nose going to the finger, and they are same in the entire pathway throughout the course of the movement, it is called a simple kinetic tremor. But in intention tremor or terminal tremor, as the finger approaches the target, the tremors will increase. And during the initial first half, the tremors are not so much. And as it reaches the target, there will be crescendo, hike up in the tremor. That is intention tremor. And third one is a task-specific kinetic tremor, like in writing tremor. In writing tremor, there can be two types. One is actually when you are holding and just about to start. And second one, when you are actually doing the writing task. So that is task-specific kinetic tremor. So please remember rest tremor, action tremor. In action tremor, common is postural and kinetic. So resting tremor, you know all Parkinson's disease and Parkinsonian syndromes, they are having resting tremor. But severe essential tremor can have rest tremor. Wilson disease usually has postural tremor, but it can have resting tremor also. The interesting entity, which is midbrain or rubral tremor, also called as Holmes tremor, named after Gordon Holmes. So Holmes tremor can have all these components, resting also, postural also, and intention also. But because it is a cerebellar outflow tremor, the intention component is more in Holmes tremor. That is the maximum, followed by postural and resting tremor. In postural, as you know, your enhanced physiological tremor, essential tremor, task-associated tremors, cerebellar disease, intention tremor, of course, cerebellar disease, multiple sclerosis because it will affect cerebellar outflow, midbrain stroke or Holmes tremor I discussed, midbrain trauma, same. So it is basically cerebellar outflow. This is again a slide that how you will examine the patient. So resting, you know, body part should be absolutely at rest. But one more thing, when you are not able to elicit the tremor, you can give mental activation or stressful questions or tasks for the patient. Like you can ask them to count months backwards, like December, November, October, like that. Or you can ask them to count 100 to 1 in reverse order. Or you can give them 100 minus 3 or 100 minus 7. That will aggravate or incite the resting tremor, which were not visible in the initial part. Postural, I told you, outstretched arms. Kinetic, I told you, finger-nose test. With toes, you can do toe-to-finger test. And isometric is by pushing the wall or making the fist. Now the next question, what is not true about essential tremor? Option A, there can be subtle impairment or very minimal impairment of coordination or tandem walking. Option B, essential tremor has micrographia like Parkinson's disease. Option C, there is approximate 50% positive family history in autosomal dominant fashion. Option D, beta blockers and primidone are standard drug treatment options, helping in about 50% of the patients. So get ready. Your timer starts now. This is what is not true about essential tremor. Please mark correct option. Great. The ET has micrographia like Parkinson's disease is not true. So I'll come to that. ET is the most common movement disorder. We have marked this as one of the questions. This is high frequency tremor, 6 to 10 hertz. This is also an MCQ. It is a postural or action upper limb tremor. This is an MCQ. Bilateral and symmetric, but it can be asymmetric and it may remain asymmetric. Please note this. And next two lines are also important. If it is a very severe essential tremor, it may have intention tremor with overshoot component because it is said that cerebellum is also involved. One more thing, as we discussed, there can be resting tremor in very severe essential tremor. And other than upper limbs, what are other parts which are involved? So in 30%, there can be head involvement, 20% there can be voice involvement, 20% tongue, 10% face and jaw, and lower limb involvement is less, it is 10%. Now, when you see voice tremor, when the person is doing communicating with you, conversing with you, you can make out voice tremors. Otherwise, how you will assess? You will ask patient to say in a continuous tone. And if there is a shakiness, like that shakiness, you can make out for the voice tremors. You can also ask patient to say E. So prolonged E sound can also be asked. That is for voice tremor. Now, please remember, there can be subtle impairment of coordination. And if you ask patient to do tandem walking, there can be subtle impairment. There will not be any profound cerebellar features, but subtle impairment can be there in this patient. And we all know 50% will have positive family history. Some alcohol response could be there, and beta blockers and primidones can help in 50%. Now, regarding MCQ, essential tremor and cerebellar tremor, they will have megalographia or macrographia, that is large handwriting, as opposed to micrographia in Parkinson's disease, which is a smaller handwriting. So just a quick video regarding resting tremor. See, it is very obvious. The arm, the hand, wrist, fingers are at resting on the lap. And you can see it. It is asymmetric in nature, Parkinson's disease. Next one.
48.
Here, patient was not getting very good tremors. So I told him to count reverse. And you can see subtle tremors here.
43.
Very subtle tremors. I hope the video is visible.
39.
30. Yes, it's clear, but it's okay.
42.
Is the movement visible here in this left thumb?
Yes, sir. It's visible. Visible. Movement is visible. Slight movement is
visible. Okay. Can be appreciated. Hello.
Leg movements are not visible. Leg.
Only left thumb I wanted to show.
Yeah.
I hope that is very subtle, but it is appreciated.
The thumb movement, mild movement is visible.
Correct. Okay, great. Now here we can see the very obvious leg tremors. And it is asymmetric. Right is affected more than the left. Now, this is how you see for the postural tremors. There is some posturing also. This is how you see postural leg tremors. You ask patient to flex the hip, flex the knee, and slight dorsiflexion of the foot, and you see the tremors. I hope this leg tremor is seen well. And tongue tremor. So please note, the tongue inside mouth is to be checked for fasciculations. Tongue should be kept in mouth. For tremors, you have to ask patient to protrude the tongue. Right. So moving to the next question, question 6, What are the two axes of dystonia classification as per Movement Disorder Society Task Force, the classification given in 2013? Option A, age and gender. Option B, clinical and etiologic. Option C, primary and secondary. Option D, physiological and pathological. Option E, hereditary and acquired. So the timer has started. Please select single best option. Okay, so correct answer is clinical and etiologic. Previously, the dystonia was classified as primary and secondary, but after pattern, because single-sided muscles, agonists and antagonists are contracting simultaneously, it can give a twisting appearance also. But what is important that there can be tremulous or tremor-like appearance for the dystonic movements. Please note, dystonia is often initiated or worsened by voluntary action. So if you see a patient who's not having obvious dystonia, you have to ask them to do some action in terms of speech, talking, upper limb movements, or you can just ask patient to walk and see how the muscles are going into dystonic appearance. As I told you, there can be co-contraction of agonist and antagonist. Now, interesting phenomenon is sensory trick or just antagonist or alleviating maneuver. What is it? Imagine a patient is having dystonia. Imagine if you can see me, if the patient is having left-sided rotation of the neck, which is called as left rotacolis, and if the patient just touches without giving any counter forceful pressure to relieve it, but a gentle pressure on the cheek or a gentle pressure near the eye, and if his dystonia is getting reduced or relieved, it is called a sensory trick through which by simple touch, the dystonia can be reduced or can be alleviated. That is why it is called as gest antagonist. Gest means gesture, antagonist means which is opposite, and alleviating maneuver. So we'll come to that. This I told you, there are two axes, clinical and etiology. In clinical, we have age of onset, that is infancy, childhood, adolescence, early and late adulthood. Body distribution, if it is a single part, like only cervical dystonia, you will call it as focal. If you have upper cranial like blepharospasm and cranial like cervical dystonia, so it will be called as craniocervical segmental dystonia. Multifocal, that is non-contiguous two or more structures. If there is, imagine cervical dystonia and foot dystonia, they are non-contiguous, it is multifocal. Generalized means trunk and other two structures. Hemidystonia means, as you know, like hemiparesis or hemichorea syndromes, like half of the body. There can be disease course which is static or progressive, persistent, action specific, like task specific, diurnal, because some dystonias worsen as the day progresses, paroxysmal, I told you, episodic in nature. It can be isolated or combined. What is isolated? Isolated means there is only and only dystonia and tremor associated with dystonia. So imagine a patient is having, again, same example, left-sided rotacolis, and if he tries to bring it in the center, the muscle pull to the left will cause this tremor. The opposing actions will lead to tremor, and this is typically called as no-no tremor in cervical dystonia. Combined means it is associated with other movement disorders like myoclonus or Parkinsonism and other neurological manifestations like spasticity, rigidity, ataxia, or many of those. Etiology can be depending on the pathology, like structural lesion or degeneration. Structural lesion could be stroke. And again, inherited or acquired. Inherited means, again, dominant recessive. Acquired could be drug, toxin, brain injury, anything. In these two axes, dystonia is classified. Again, these details I have mentioned, but for the want of time, I will just move ahead. So this is a nursing staff. All these videos I have taken permission for the academic purpose. This is a nursing staff who took antiemetic injection, and see, she is getting this neck extended with eyes rolling upwards. So this is called as neck extension, retrocolis, and there is oculogyria, eyes sustain upward rotation. This is because of drug induced, commonly involving upper cranial and cervical muscles. This is relieved by anticholinergics, promethazine or Avil. This is the patient having right-sided ganglio-capsular stroke, having left foot dystonia. So there is extension of the left great toe and flexion of the rest of the toes. This patient, we tried to give botulinum toxin. There was around 60 to 70% relief. So this is a structural etiology. So this is a focal dystonia. If you see the classification, clinical description, and based on etiology. Now this patient, I was recording him and I was telling him, you please look straight to the camera. But his neck was automatically going towards his right side. And whenever he was trying to look straight, there was a tremor, no kind of a tremor. And on outstretched arms, if you see carefully, there is a pattern, fingers are going into the pattern, that is dystonic posturing. And there is a tremor in bilateral upper limbs, which you will appreciate. So first, I would like all of you to focus on his neck. See, there is a sternocleidomastoid prominence also. So right rotocollis, left SCM prominence. And there is a tremor when he looks straight because the muscles are getting pulled and he's trying to bring into the neutral position. There is one more interesting entity called as null point. If the patient is getting tremor and if he looks towards the action of maximum muscle pull, if he looks towards his right, the tremors will reduce. So that is called as null point. And in upper limb, you can see there is dystonic posturing and dystonic tremors. This is a very interesting phenomenon. Why I have kept this? Because this is also an MCQ, that feeding dystonia or feeding lingual dystonia can be seen in which condition? That is called as chorioacanthocytosis, part of neuroacanthocytosis syndromes. So these are all neurological syndromes with peripheral smear showing acanthocytes. Chorioacanthocytosis is because of VPS13A mutation. That is also an MCQ. So whenever this lady tries to eat, actually she will not keep the food on the tip of the tongue because there is a feeding dystonia, tongue comes out and she will bite the tongue and there will be mutilation or the bite of the tongue or inner part of the cheeks, and there is an injury. So what she does, she will just put in the side pockets of the cheek, or she will extend the neck and put it in the back of the throat to avoid that feeding dystonia and tongue bite. So chorioacanthocytosis, please note, they will have this C. The food is coming out as soon as there is tongue dystonia, the food will drop out. So these patients can have seizures also, peripheral neuropathy also, myopathy also. They can have tics also. And there is interesting phenomenon in chorioacanthocytosis is if you watch them, there will be sudden head drop. So that is also a part of chorioacanthocytosis. Next, the question is, what is the most common form of focal dystonia? Is it spasmodic dysphonia, cervical dystonia, limb dystonia, writer's cramp, or blepharospasm? So the timer has started. Please choose single best option. Okay, great. The correct option is cervical dystonia, right? So most common form of focal dystonia is cervical one. Now in this classification, which we discussed just now, I told you isolated dystonia means only dystonia and the dystonic tremor will be seen. Combined is dystonia and other movement disorder like Parkinsonism and myoclonus. Complex dystonia means there will be many other features and dystonia could be one of the several clinical features. Now, in adult onset focal dystonia, this is the most frequent form of isolated dystonia. So all those isolated dystonia where you just have dystonia and tremor, it is focal dystonia. And commonly females are more affected than men. The ratio is 2:1, typically seen in 4th to 6th decade. And as you know, the question which I asked, cervical dystonia, cervical is the most common focal dystonia, around 50% involved. Next could be blepharospasm, bilateral eye tight spasm or blinking, recurrent blinking. Now, blepharospasm can be so severe that they cannot read, and it can lead to even functional blindness. So botulinum toxin can give very nice results in blepharospasm. Or in general, that is, I would say, treatment of choice in focal dystonias. Next, uncommon ones are focal hand and leg dystonia, spasmodic dysphonia. Now, what is spasmodic dysphonia? There are two types, like laryngeal dystonia. There is adductor type, when there is a straining voice or strained, as if someone is strangling the neck. That kind of a voice, which is commoner, adductor dystonia or dysphonia. And less common is the abductor one, where the sound is more breathy or fluidy kind of a sound. There can be musician's dystonia also. If you just see some people playing the piano, their fingers may go into posturing. That is called as musician's dystonia or pianist dystonia. Some people having strumming like guitar, if they get dystonia of the fingers, that is also musician's dystonia, depending on the instrument. There is something called as embouchure dystonia also, where the lips can get dystonic posturing. Oromandibular dystonia, where jaw can be clenched or jaw can be opened. I mean, jaw will be in the open state. So that is called as jaw opening dystonia. Jaw will remain open. So there is difficulty in chewing and speech. Jaw closure dystonia, jaw will be tight. There can be jaw deviation dystonia also, right? And please note, focal dystonias can progress to involve other structures also. So if it involves from neck to upper limb, it can be called as segmental. Okay, next question. I think I have given some clue already in the previous questions about this. So what is true regarding sensory jest or sensory trick or jest antagonist? Option A, also called as alleviating maneuver. Option B, even the imagination of sensory trick can reduce dystonic activity. Option C, a sensory trick-like stimuli which worsens the dystonia is called as reverse sensory trick. And option D, all of these. So the timer started. Great. So all of these is the correct answer. So what is sensory trick and jest antagonist? I told you that certain actions or certain movements will alter some sensory input and improve, temporarily improve the dystonic posture or the movement. So if you see blepharospasm patients, sometimes by speech or by talking, their blepharospasm improves. Or if they just touch the outer canthus of the eye, it improves. For the neck, I told you some people touch the cheek. It is not really the push or the maximum force, but the gentle touch can give this relief. That is why it is called as sensory trick. But what Jankovic, who is a doyen in the movement disorder field, what he said that, see, it is not a magical trick. It is, and one more thing, it is a real phenomenon. So it is not the fake thing. So it should not be called as a trick. And one more thing, not just sensory, there can be some motor inputs also, or motor maneuvers also, which can help in reducing this. So he said this should be called as alleviating maneuver. And one more interesting thing is, reverse sensory trick is a sensory trick-like stimulus which will worsen the dystonia. And even the imagination can reduce the dystonia just by imagination. Sensory trick is seen around 50 to 70% of the dystonias. Now this patient, if you see, watch his tongue. It is going typically towards the left. So he's getting basically orolingual dystonia. And what was his sensory trick? By keeping a simple paper strip held inside the mouth. See, his movements have reduced. That is called as sensory trick. And every person will have his or her own different tricks. Some people will put even the toothpick inside the mouth. Some people have seen using the betel nut small, keeping inside the mouth to relieve this. Right? So sensory jest or jest antagonist, sensory trick or alleviating maneuver. Now, I told you, usually it is not a forcible counter pressure. But if you see these patients, for their jaw opening dystonia or oromandibular dystonia, they are using a very strong force on the lower jaw to try to close the jaw. So it is a forcible type of a gest antagonist or a gest, sensory gest. This is particularly seen in pecan. Pantothenate kinase associated neurodegeneration. It is actually a type of NVIA. What is NVIA? It is a neurodegeneration with brain iron accumulation, where iron is accumulated and it can give multiple movement disorders and other neurological manifestations. So if there is an MCQ, I doubt it will come or not, but the forcible gest is seen in PECAN or NBIA1. Next one, which is the most common cause of early onset generalized dystonia? Option A, mutation in TOR1A gene, that is previously called as DYT1 gene, mutation in TAP1, option C, KMT2B mutation, and option D, VPS13A. I think option D we have discussed, so it should be easier now. So the timer has started. Most common cause of early onset generalized dystonia. Great. So first option is correct and 93% have marked it correct. So DYT1, previously it was called as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, but now they say the particular gene locus should be mentioned. So DYT TOR1A, DYT KMT2B, that way it should be mentioned, right? But maybe old examiners or still the pattern may continue. So you should know that table from Harrison and the latest dystonia classification or this genetic foci. I think it has gone up to DYT2828. So that you should know. And the common ones, I think you should do. So of course, TOR1A is the most common genetic form of dystonia. The TOR1A gene, it is the most common early onset generalized dystonia. So what happens? It is usually a limb onset in childhood and later it progresses to involve other body parts. But classically or typically, it spares the face and the neck. So please note, if you see early onset isolated generalized dystonia, 40 to 65% of non-Jewish will have this DYT TOR1A and 90% of the Ashkenazi Jewish will have this involvement. Now, KMT2B is almost similar. The phenotype or the phenocopy almost matches to TOR1A. So if your genetic analysis is negative for TOR1A, you should definitely look for KMT2B. And please note, both of these have excellent response to deep brain stimulation surgery. The dystonia responds very well compared to other dystonias. Next question, what is not true about DOPA responsive dystonia or DRD? Option A, also called as Segawa syndrome. Option B, there is mutation in GCH1 gene, that is GTP cyclohydrolase 1. Option C, it is a childhood onset form with diurnal fluctuations. Option D, it responds to low dose levodopa. Option E, it does not have Parkinsonism with presynaptic dopaminergic deficit. So please note, the question is, what is not true? The timer has started. Okay, great. So the not true option is does not have Parkinsonism, because it can have Parkinsonism with presynaptic dopaminergic deficit. So it is also known as Segawa syndrome, yes. GCH1 gene mutation, yes. It will have diurnal fluctuations and it is childhood onset, yes. It responds to low dose, as low as even half tablet or 100 milligram or lesser than that tablet, giving dramatic relief. So it is usually said that all young onset dystonias, you should try levodopa. Levodopa challenge should be taken to look for the improvement in dystonia. So it is known as Segawa disease. Onset is in early childhood and later it progresses to generalized dystonia. It can have Parkinsonian features, I told you. Diurnal features, as the day progresses, there can be worsening. And post-sleep, there is improvement. Most common DOPA-responsive dystonia. See, DOPA-responsive dystonia phenotype, it can be seen in three mutations. One is GCH1, which is most common. That is Segawa disease. It is autosomal dominant. And other one is autosomal recessive, that is rare in nature, tyrosine hydroxylase or TH mutation. Third one is sepiapterin reductase gene mutation.
Excuse me, sir, the slide is not moving, I guess. It is stuck in the previous,
Oh, which one? It is still on the question?
Yeah, Slido, that one.
Has it moved?
Not yet, still.
Has it moved?
Not yet, still in the Slido, that live quiz session.
Okay, I think it got stuck.
Yeah, I thought it was just for me. I think someone has put in the chat box also.
Now it is moving?
No, sir. Same.
Oh, I think I should just stop share and do it again.
Yeah, you can do that.
I'm sorry for this technical glitch. Is it visible?
The same slide is being seen. The Slido, that 10th question, Slido, that screen
now?
Is being... No, sir, the same one.
It is not moving?
Not moving.
Now?
Same, sir.
It is moving for me.
Yeah, it's not. The same screen is being seen.
Okay, I think I will... I don't know, it's...
Mansi ji, are you there? She must have...
What about other people? They are also feeling it like...
Yeah, they are also feeling. I thought it was stuck just for me because of my network.
Because issue. I am able to move it.
But chat also there. Can you put in the chat box whether... they are all are putting the same thing, sir. It's stuck on Slido. They are putting the same thing, sir. Stuck. They are putting in the same things.
Okay, give me a minute.
Yes. I think I'll just call up Mansi, whether she's...
I think I should re-log in maybe. Because my slides are moving.
Okay. I'll just get help from Mansi also. Meanwhile... You have logged back in, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. And you can share it.
I don't know why it is getting stuck.
You have started your share screen again?
No, I'm clicking, but it's kind of freezing.
Okay.
But meanwhile, the Slido is working well.
Yeah,
previous questions, people could access it and.
Yeah. Actually, I had queries. I was telling them how to clear it in the chat box. I think people were doing it well till now. Yeah, Mansi has come back, I think.
I don't know. My slide is freezing.
Again.
Previously, it was moving. Now, once I stopped, it is freezing.
Now we cannot see your slide. You haven't started your share.
Did I get logged out? You said Mansi is back. I mean, I was logged out, is it? I didn't know that.
You were logged
out. Yes, now I am already in the meeting.
I think there is some issue with the sir's. Like it was getting stuck in the Slido, that face. Sir, can okay. You restart your share?
Yeah, I'm doing that.
Okay.
Yeah, is it visible now?
No, sir. No, not yet.
No, not yet.
the issue.
Yeah, now it's saying that you're starting your screen sharing, and now it has come.
Is it full screen?
No, it's in your PPT mode, not in the slideshow mode.
Is it in the edit mode?
It is in your PowerPoint. Yeah, now it has come in the slideshow mode.
Okay, great. Is it okay? Shall I proceed?
Yes, sir. But a bit of clarity is less, but I think it will come up in due course of time.
Dr. Ashish, if you feel that there are not any more videos ahead, you can stop the optimize.
There are videos.
Okay. Because the slide is going blur.
No, there are videos. Is it very blurred?
Yes. Not readable. Dr. Subir, can you read the slide?
No, it's not readable.
Yeah, it's not readable.
Is it because of the Slido, sir?
No, it is, I think.
No, Dr. Ashish, what you can do is, you can do that. You can switch off your video. And Dr. Subir, you can also switch off your video.
Okay, now it's clear.
Now I stopped the optimization for video. So I don't know how the videos will appear.
Now it's very clear.
The sound will not be shared.
Okay, let's see. So anyways, I'll come to the...
Maybe only for the video slide, you can just do new share, optimize screen sharing, finish the video and then again uncheck if that is feasible.
Okay. I'll do that. No problem. Let's see. So I'll move to next one. So I told you DOPA responsive dystonia, autosomal dominant GCH1, autosomal recessive tyrosine hydroxylase, and very rare one is sepiapterin reductase. Is the question 11 visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. Which gene is involved in classical myoclonus dystonia? Option A, SGCE, that is epsilon sarcoglycan. Option B, ATP1A3. Option C, Tata box binding protein associated factor 1. Option D, GCH1 gene. So I think one option is already gone. The timer has started. Great. So the classical myoclonus dystonia, previously called as DYT11, can be seen in epsilon sarcoglycan. So just see the video. Is the video visible?
Yes. But it's getting stuck, sir. It's not that smooth. The video is not that smooth because I think you haven't optimized.
Okay, now.
It's
is it visible?
It's visible, but it's interrupted.
Oh.
Since it's a movement disorder, like it's not that smoothly seen. I think people can make it out.
Okay. So if you see, there is upper body myoclonic jerk, and there is dystonic posturing of the fingers and the wrist. It is going into ulnar deviation. So there is myoclonus plus dystonia. Myoclonus more in the upper body region or upper half. The slide is visible?
Not clear. Readable, but not that clear. Yeah, now it's clear.
Okay. So it is basically action-induced alcohol-responsive myoclonic jerks. Whenever patient is trying to outstretch or lift anything, there will be myoclonic jerks, predominantly upper body half. Onset is usually in childhood or adolescent age. There can be additional psychiatric features like anxiety, depression, and alcohol dependence. This myoclonic jerks can respond to alcohol. So sometimes they may start consuming more alcohol to suppress it. And mutation, the classical one, DYT11, is epsilon sarcoglycan or SGCE gene. There are non-SDC gene-associated myoclonic dystonia also. Now the next question, what is augmentation in RLS? Option A, it is the reappearance or worsening of symptoms at a time related to drug's short half-life. Option B, spread and worsening of restlessness and appearance earlier in the day. Option C, symptoms appear in head and neck region. Option D, all of these. So the timer has started.
RLS is restless leg syndrome for you.
Yeah, yeah. RLS is restless leg syndrome. Okay. So the correct option is spread and worsening of restlessness and its appearance. So first, let's discuss what is restless leg syndrome. It affects 10% of the adult population. Secondary RLS, we should look common in pregnancy. We should search for anemia and ferritin deficiency or iron workup, renal failure, and peripheral neuropathy. So what are the core features, four core features of RLS or restless leg syndrome? So there is urge to move the legs because there is unpleasant sensation in the legs. These symptoms begin or worsen with the rest. Patient typically says that in the evening or the night, he's resting, sitting, or trying to lie down before sleep, and he feels some, as if insects are crawling, some weird sensation in the legs. And he feels there is partial or complete relief by movement. So there is this restlessness in the legs, and he moves about to relieve it. And as I told you, there is worsening during evening or night. Now, treatment options. We can use pramipexole, ropinirole, roticotone patch, and it should be taken 1 to 2 hours before bedtime. So very first time, I think levodopa was tried, and it had the issue of augmentation. What is augmentation? Augmentation of the disease or the symptoms. There is restlessness getting spread to other regions like upper limb, head, or trunk and arms. And there is worsening of restlessness. The severity is more, the intensity is more. And what is rebound? Rebound is a different phenomenon. It is end of the dose rebound. That means the drug, whatever you are giving to relieve it, as soon as the drug's action ends, drug's half-life is over, the symptoms will reappear, right? So augmentation can be seen in dopamine agonists also. Right. Next, question 13. Which condition shows this MRI appearance, which is marked in the red color box? This appearance is seen in which condition? Option A, Wilson disease. Option B, Parkinson disease. Option C, MSA, multiple system atrophy. Option D, PSP, progressive supranuclear palsy. The timer has started. I hope people could watch it for enough time. Okay. The correct answer is Wilson disease. So this is basically, see, there are two appearances. One is in the midbrain, one is in the pons. So what you see in the midbrain is face of the giant panda appearance. And what you see in the pons is called as face of the panda cub. So these two, the panda related signs are seen in Wilson disease. I will not go into the individual details, where is the hyperintensity and hypointensity. But the classical picture, if you see, which matches like red nucleus showing the eyes of the panda, that is how you should recognize that this appearance is matching the face of the giant panda and Wilson's disease. Next, what is not true about KF ring? Option A, present in virtually all patients with neurologic Wilson disease. Option B, present in 80% of the patient with hepatic manifestation. Option C, there is deposition of copper in desmoid membrane. Option D, it is best detected by fluorescein angiography. Option E, it may reduce or disappear with decoppering or copper chelation therapy. So the timer has started. What is not true about KF ring? Okay, so best detected by fluorescein angiography? No, it is basically used. Slit lamp is the best one, and in the initial stage where you have clinical suspicion and with naked eyes if you can't see, slit lamp should be used. Okay, so why do we get all this greenish yellow, golden yellow, brownish golden, brownish yellow color? So it is basically copper deposited as granular complex with sulfur, and that gives the color. It appears initially in the superior, like 12 o'clock, and then inferiorly 6 o'clock position. So you can't just look straight. You should elevate the lid and ask patient to look up and down and see for the appearance. And of course, as the disease advances, it will be visible clearly circumferentially. It can give appearance as sunflower cataract because of the deposition in the lens capsule. And please note, there is no impairment of vision because of KF ring and the sunflower cataract. And whenever there is decoppering or copper gelation, these cataracts and the rings will disappear or reduce. And if the patient is worsening, and if patient stops the therapy, there will be reappearance of the ring. So clinically, you can monitor if the patient is taking it treatment correctly or not. So this greenish haze in the periphery, here very minimal rim in the superior inferior border, here very well circumferential border. Here if you see in slit lamp, there is that golden brown appearance. In OCT also they say that there is a band which is thick appearance. And sunflower cataract, if you see the radiating spoke wheel like appearance or sunflower cataract appearance in the Wilson disease. And slit lamp should be used for both of these. Next one, which movement disorder is a prominent feature of serotonin syndrome, and it can differentiate it from neuroleptic malignant syndrome or NMS? Option A, myoclonus. Option B, tremor. Option C, chorea. Option D, tics. The timer has started. Right, so myoclonus is the correct option. So let's come to the difference. Serotonin syndrome, it is usually seen within the 24 hours of the serotonergic drug intake and the reaction is seen. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome takes a few days to weeks. Neuromuscular findings, serotonin syndrome will have hyperreactive phenomenon like tremor, hyperreflexia, myoclonus, inducible or obvious clonus. And NMS will have bradyreflexia, severe rigidity, and it will not have myoclonus or hyperreflexia. So myoclonus was the option. Causative agents, we know serotonergic agents, dopamine blockers, neuroleptic agents. What are the treatment agents? Initially, benzodiazepines can be used, but cipropeptidine is kind of an antidote. In neuroleptic malignant syndrome, we can use benzodiazepines as well as dantrolene, bromocriptine, and amantadine. And resolution is like an onset quick in serotonin syndrome, but again, it will take more time in neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Both will have this autonomic dysfunction, hyperthermia, rigidity, all these features. So hyperreflexive myoclonus, you should remember, is rare in NMS and common in serotonin syndrome. Just a quick mention of Hunter criteria for serotonin syndrome. It is considered as highly specific and sensitive. So patient should have history of serotonergic agent or drug intake and should have one of the following. What is that? Either a spontaneous clonus or inducible clonus and agitation diaphoresis, ocular clonus plus agitation diaphoresis, tremor and hyperreflexia, hypertonia, temperature more than 38 degrees Celsius, plus ocular clonus or inducible clonus. So the criteria name you should remember, Hunter's criteria. Next one, this is a very classic picture. What is the appearance in the MRI and what is the condition associated with it? Option A, eye of the tiger and pecan. Option B, eye of the penguin and B-pan. Option C, hummingbird sign and M-pan. And option D, mustache sign and copan. This pecan, B-pan, M-pan, copan, these are all NBIAs, neurodegeneration with brain iron accumulation disorders. These are the short forms of the conditions. Okay, so please note the condition MRI and choose the option. Timer has started. Great, everyone knows this. It is eye of the tiger and it is seen in PCAN. So if you see carefully, the eye of the tiger appearance, it is seen here. But if you see the MRI straight, you will see the slant is like opposite. But if you see reverse in this image, if you hold it ulta, upside down, the appearance will match it. Like, look at this appearance. It will match the appearance of the eye of the tiger. So this was mentioned or the described first by Dr. Kapil Sethi, an Indian settled in US. He is also a big name in movement disorders. He described in way back in 1988. Now this condition that time was previously called as Hallowarden-Spaatz syndrome. But because these names, the scientists or the doctors were involved in Hitler's Nazi camps and with some experiment with Jews killing and their brain pathology experiments, their names have been taken off. And now it is called based on the neurodegeneration brain accumulation type 1 or pantothenate kinase associated neurodegeneration, PCAN or NBIA type 1. So that is classical eye of the tiger appearance. Now, for the want of time, I will not go into the details. But NBIA, you know, that is PCAN because of PANC2 gene, phospholipase associated neurodegeneration, that is PLAN, that is PLATO-G6, MPAN is C19ORF12 gene mutation, acerebroplasminia is because of ceruloplasmin gene, and other one, Kufur-Rakeb, FAN, Woodhouse-Sakati. Woodhouse-Sakati will have alopecia and diabetes. Neuroferritinopathy is seen in adults. Acerebroplasminemia, you should remember, is seen in adults. What is one more interesting thing is BPAN. BPAN is seen in X-linked dominant inheritance, and neuroferritinopathy is seen as autosomal dominant inheritance, but rest all are autosomal recessive. So that is also an MCQ, that all are autosomal recessive, all except or something like that. So this list I have given just the names and their genes. You can refer it later. Now, question 17, which of the following drug belong to the class VMAT2 inhibitor? Option A, tetrabenazine and valbenazine. Option B, tetrabenazine and levobenazine. Option C, valbenazine, deutetrabenazine and tetrabenazine. Option D, tetrabenazine, levobenazine, dextrobenazine. And option E, none of these. So the timer has started. Okay, 52% have marked it correctly. Right. So valbenazine, deutetrabenazine, and tetrabenazine. These are VMAT2 inhibitors, vesicular monoamine transporter 2 inhibitors. And these three drugs are there. Tetrabenazine, we all know. But it is the deuterated version of racemic tetrabenazine is called as deutetrabenazine. The deuteration causes slowing of metabolism. So half-life is more. So it can be given as OD dose or less frequent dosing, and it reduces metabolic variability also. So side effect profile is better. Please note tetrabenazine causes sedation, depression, and Parkinsonism. So if you are giving tetrabenazine in the patient of tics, and if he is developing or you're giving in chorea in a hyperkinetic disorder, but he's slowly developing Parkinsonian feature, you should see the tetrabenazine as the culprit. Now, valbenazine is the alpha isomer of tetrabenazine associated with amino acid valine. It causes slow release upon cleavage and rapid metabolism to active moiety called alpha dihydro tetrabenazine. So these three are VMAT2 inhibitors, vesicular monoamine transporter 2 inhibitors. I think these first two are not available in India as of now. They are available in US, and commonly they are used in tardive dyskinesias. Okay, next question. Which is the most common subacute drug-induced movement disorder? So it is about drug-induced movement disorder, but which is the subacute one most common? Option A, dystonia. Option B, akathisia. Option C, tardive dyskinesia. Option D, action-induced myoclonus. Timer has started. See, all these are basically factual questions and more of clinical questions rather than more of pathophysiology. Right? So many of you know it, right? Akathisia is the most common subacute drug-induced movement disorder. So what about other reactions? So in drug-induced movement disorders, we have acute, subacute, and tardive. Tardive means something which is delayed or late, or let's say chronic. So what appears late? So dystonia is the most common acute hyperkinetic drug reaction. I just showed you nursing staff with retrocolis, with oculogyria. Akathisia or restlessness is most common reaction in subacute category, and tardive dyskinesia. See, there are tardive syndromes. In tardive syndromes, there can be tardive dyskinesia, tardive dystonia, tardive tremor, long tardive, many other tardive syndromes. In that, tardive dyskinesia is the most common, which can involve choriform movements or dystonic movements. And in 1/3 of the patients, this dyskinesia will remit or resolve within 3 months of stopping the drug, and most patients will gradually improve over the course of several years. Right? So this is also kind of MCQ, that 1/3 will improve in 3 months after stoppage of drugs. So commonly seen in neuroleptic drugs. So what is akathisia? Akathisia means inability to sit still or quiet. So it is the inner restlessness, and it is relieved when patient moves about. So when seated, patient may just touch or caress the scalp, cross uncross legs, rock the trunk to and fro. Patient may just squirm, move the legs in right and left or abducted up. Patient may just get out of the chair and move around, may even do some noises. And this inner restlessness is relieved by this moving about, right? So these are usually complex, but stereotype. Stereotype means more or less similar and appearing same over time, such kind of movements. And they are transiently suppressive. So just see this patient. So he's rubbing his hands over the thighs. He just crossed his arms over the chest. He got up, again crossed his arms over the chest. Again, he's moving, rubbing the arms. Again, he will sit, rubbing the arms. So there is inner restlessness. And he says that when he moves around, there is a relief in that inner restlessness. So akathisia, please note, most common cause of akathisia is iatrogenic because of the drugs used. But other conditions like Parkinsonian conditions also can have akathisia. Parkinson's disease also can have akathisia. Next question. Balism can be seen in the lesions of the following, except. So which of these areas are involved in balism except? Option A, the subthalamic nucleus. Option B, putamen. Option C, thalamus. Option D, parietal cortex. Option E, substantia nigra. So the timer has started. So balism can be seen in ST, in putamen, thalamus, parietal cortex. That is right, but not in substantia nigra lesions. So what is balism? See, if you see athetosis, which is a small, writhing, worm-like movement, then if you see chorea, which is a random movement flowing from one body part to other, and if you see higher version of it or violent form of choriform movements, it is called as balism. So these are wild, flinging, large amplitude movements. They affect the proximal limbs. That's why you see flinging movements. Patient can hit the person sitting next to him or even hit the wall and hurt himself. If it involves one side of the body, it is hemivalism. If it is only one limb, it is called as monovalism. If it involves upper both limbs or lower both limbs, it is called as paravalism. And most common cause we know, a partial lesion which can be infarct or bleed in the ST and subthalamic nucleus, and other lesions could be in the putamen, thalamus, or parietal cortex. So what are the drugs to control valism? Yes, dopamine blocking neuroleptics can be used. Usually it is self-limiting, and if it is very severe, uncontrollable with the pharmacotherapy, you can do pyridotomy, which is a lesioning therapy of the lesioning in the pallidum, or deep brain stimulation in the globus pallidus interna, GPIDBS, which we use for dystonias also. So a quick video regarding choreobalism.
Yeah.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir, but the video is breaking actually.
But choppy?
Okay. Yeah, choppy kind of videos.
So the movements are random. You cannot predict whether they will appear at shoulder or elbow, at wrist or fingers. And they are wide. See, he's trying to lock it by holding the inner thigh or in between the thighs. So very, very transient suppression is possible in choreas, but usually it is not suppressible. And these are large amplitude movements while flinging and involving proximal musculature. So here it is right upper limb and right lower limb involvement. Just see how far his upper limb went. See, suddenly wide range movement. So this is valism. So he's trying to hold it. Hello.
Hi. Hello, sir. I think the video has got stuck and your slide is not that clear. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah. Slide is on the video?
No, the video has gone and the slide has come. One question is arisen.
Okay, the question 20 is visible?
Yeah, just visible. You can proceed, sir.
Okay.
Reduce the optimization to make the question more clear.
There will be no videos henceforth.
There is one video. Hello.
Okay. I think you can just read the question, sir, and we'll anyway you will be repeating the question in the Slido app, I guess.
Okay, so I will just move. So yeah, the child is having increased blinking, head jerking, along with sniffing sounds, throat clearing sounds. So what are the preferred treatment options for his syndrome? Option A, neuroleptics like risperidone, haloperidol. Option B, fluoxetine.
Sir, we couldn't find a video. Did you show any video for the child? Hello, sir? The video was not seen.
No.
Okay, fine.
Video was not there. Only okay. The question.
Okay, sir. Okay. Carry on, sir.
The timer has started. My slide is...
No, your slide is gone.
Yeah. Hello, sir.
Dr. Ashish, yeah, he's back.
Yes, sir.
I got logged out. Is it visible?
Yeah, right now we are back. You are on the Slido. That thing is on. Yeah, that
was it marked?
Yeah, that was marked actually.
I think again the timer has started.
Okay.
Okay, alpha agonist like clonidine and guanfacine, that's the correct option. Great. So I will just tell you, the Joban Deol has got the first rank, 17 correct. I think because of the timer quick answering, he has gone the first rank. Next is SV with correct option 17 correct. Ravi Prakash Singh 16, Monica 15, Shravan 14.
Congrats, everyone. Congrats.
Yeah. So it's more of attempting it.
Yeah.
And the rank and the marks.
Yes.
So I'll just come to Tourette syndrome. So this boy is having Tourette syndrome with ADHD, right? Attention deficit hyperactivity disorders. This boy should be treated with guanfacine and clonidine, because in ADHD, they are the preferred and effective agents, right? But behavioral for very high, those who are not getting relieved by habit reversal trainings or behavioral modification trainings, they need pharmacotherapy. So this was the case. And in severe tics, of course, anti-dopaminergic drugs, haloperidol, pimozide, aripiprazole can be used, and VMAT2 inhibitors like tetrabenazine with lower most dose, gradually hiked up, for disabling tics can be used, right? So I'll just show the video. So if you just saw the sudden jerk of the neck, he says that there is an inner urge to move it, and he's trying to stop it. But see the sudden jerk, there is inner urge to move it. And if he stops it, the urge and the tension, inner tension, will keep rising. And as soon as he moves it, he feels better. So this is basically a tic disorder. Tics can be of two types: motor, where the movements are seen, vocal or phonic, where the sounds will be observed. So in that also, there are simple motor or complex, or simple phonic and complex. Simple means if it is only eye blink, only head jerk, single group of muscles, it will be called as simple tics. If there are multiple group of muscles, complex movements, it is called as complex tics. Same in vocalization. If it is only sniffing, clearing of throat, it is simple vocal. If there is bad words, profanity used, foul language used, that will be called as complex vocal tics. Now this patient, here I think sound is very important. So please focus not just movements, but the sound also. Trying to stop it, but after a certain point he could not control it, and there is a grunting or growling sound along with head jerking forwards. So there is motor as well as vocal tics, young adolescent boy, Tourette syndrome. One more thing which I would like all of you to note, because this is a very hot topic and always asked in exams, that is paroxysmal genetic dyskinesia. What is PKD? It is paroxysmal kinesogenic dyskinesia. Kinesogenic means whenever there is a movement will lead to dyskinesia. Next one is PNKD, that is paroxysmal non-kinesogenic, means there is no movement, but other factors and other triggers will lead to dyskinesia. PED is paroxysmal exertional dyskinesia. I'm sorry for the goof up. So phenomenology can be chorioathetosis or dystonia in any of these. And what are the triggers? In kinesogenic, whenever there is sudden movement or sudden running or voluntary movements, the PKD can be seen. But most important is the gene, that is PRRT2. Next one is PNKD. Here it is not associated with movement, but it can be associated with coffee, tea, alcohol, stress, height of emotional state, fever. And here the gene associated is MR1, myofibrillogenesis regulator 1. And PAD, exertion-induced dystonia or dyskinesia, can be seen after prolonged exercise. Prolonged means usually more than 15 minutes, and it can involve the area or the part of the body which is doing the exercise or heavily exercising. And it can be seen in fasting also, and it is associated with SLC2A1 gene mutation, previously called as GLUT1 deficiency syndrome. So GLUT1 associated glucose transporter, facilitated glucose transport in the brain is affected. That is why post-exertion or post-exercise or in fasting state, PED can be seen. So whatever I have marked in yellow, those are the MCQs. Thank you.
Okay, sir, you're finished. So thank you,
so
sir.
I would like to thank again the Fine Forum, Dr. Ahmed Subir and Mansi ji for the help, and all the students for taking out time and participating for the this quiz. I hope it was easy, but this is to generate an interest to read from the books, to see the movement disorder phenomenology, and of course, just interest should be generated first. Then you will start reading.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Like the first question of the quiz, and I was surprised to see that many people said it was automatic. Yeah, yeah. I thought that it was pretty obvious that it would be semi-voluntary.
Okay.
Yes, sir. So, actually, lots of new stuff I have also learned regarding...
Come on, Dr. Subir. Come on.
Actually, I was telling these people who are following this Fine Neurophilia series that actually more than just following this series, they have to read the textbook. Because just seeing this video, they'll get lots of MCQs, more MCQs. You have put the points nicely in all your slides and then emphasize most of the MCQs which are recently asked. Because most of the institutes, especially NIMHANS, SAMES and Srijitra, they emphasize on the MCQs, especially in their postdoctoral fellowship courses which they are conducting, like movement disorder, stroke, epilepsy and muscle disorders, especially. So they are focusing now on movement disorders mostly, because that is a hot topic these days. So more questions are coming, especially the
general. I think people should know the common phenomenology, you will know. But I think this typical MRIs, typical signs, some genetic data, factual data, most common. Like if you see in my time, there was MCQ, which is the most common systemic disease associated with chorea. And the answer is SLE. And this line still exists in the Harrison.
Yes. Okay, sir. So I think it's already 9.
It is around 10.
Okay, so, sir. Thank you very much, sir. I think I just wanted to tell you, we are planning to do it in two sessions. And you know that this session has already covered most of the basic as well as
the advanced. Is almost covered. I think now students should read it.
Yeah, just you need to complete the bits and pieces what your sir had left in between. That is fill in the blanks. So there is, I think the basics and the advanced session has all been covered in the single session. So what is left is for you, with you to read the rest from the books, especially Harrison as well as from the Bradley. And you should know that some portions, especially like the restless leg syndrome, sir, I explained one question. In Bradley, it is extensively written. You may think that it's just a small portion. It has been written in two separate parts. You may miss the second part and all. The treatment is a separate big portion. That is more than 6 pages, I think, has been entitled.
Devoted to RLS,
Yeah. That is very important. Most questions would come from that.
Yes. The RLS augmentation, these are all very hot topics. Yeah.
And that augmentation thing only I said, sir, I didn't know about that. That was the...
Okay. And someone has asked, what is Essential Tremor Plus? So I told you Essential Tremor can have some incoordination, some tandem walk, slight attacks here, very subtle, and sometimes some cognitive impairment also. So people call all this, see, essential tremor means what? Why the term essential? Because there is only tremor as a neurological predominant prominent finding, and other subtle or non-existent findings are not there. So the term, they say that is essential. And what is plus? Because you have this some extra soft signs, very minimal cognitive, very minimal tandem ataxia. So it is called as essential tremor plus.
So,
and sorry for the technical glitch and all that, but I hope you all...
That is a mandate. When Dr. Ashish comes on with a quiz, the technical glitch is a mandate.
Yeah.
So I hope, sir, I hope that it was a privilege to have you on board, sir. And I hope that this message gets conveyed to other people, aspiring neurologists, to make best use of this session. Because it's coming in the...
I must appreciate Dr. Subir is doing wonderful job that he's generating that interest towards neurology. And really, I mean, I really appreciate that gesture.
Thank you, sir. And I hope that this message it conveys that, conveyed that this YouTube video is coming. So make best use of this video, this current video session for studying hyperkinetic movement disorder. It's a bit tougher. That's means as an MD physician, you may see diabetic striatopathy and diabetic hemichorea, but others you may just refer to a neurologist because you won't get an idea about the phenomenology and all. So that's all. So I think we'll call it a day, sir.
It is 10 o'clock and we'll call it a day, and all the best to all the students. Best wishes.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you all listeners. Thank you, Mansiji. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mansiji and Dr. Subir. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Good night.
Bye-bye. Good night.
Bye-bye.